Racism is not born in a person. Racism is taught.
It's time to have difficult conversations, to be heard, to listen, to learn about race in America.
We knew every time we took a ride that if we died, we died.
All of this because you were black.
Of course. Everything was because of that.
For the next hour, we have those conversations as our younger black journalists speak with our older Americans of color on what they've experienced, what is happening now, and their hopes for the future.
When we saw the protest that took place last summer, George Floyd protest.
George Floyd, he was like, another one?
The year 2020 was a tough year. I just said to my wife, I said, I'm tired. I'm just tired.
This is Project Community, History and Hope.
For the next hour, we're hearing from black Americans who lived through some of our country's darkest times. I'm Aaron Pickens.
Now, Marcus Hunter, they can be painful memories, but their message is mixed with wisdom and hope for future generations.
From segregation to the civil rights movement and last summer's racial reckoning, they've witnessed history. Some have even been part of it. People like George Stark Jr. He was the first black man to attend the University of Florida Law School. The 89-year-old decorated Air Force veteran talked to Stuart Moore outside his home in Orlando.
But on September 15th, 1958, when I went to the University of Florida, I didn't know what to expect.
This grainy footage shows a nervous Mr. Stark on campus receiving his registration packet, a row separating him from his white classmates on their first day.
I got to meet some of my classmates in particular, some of whom really were not my classmates, but I didn't know it at the time. Two of them were Florida Highway Patrol people. They had been assigned to assure my safety because they didn't know what to expect either, except that my name did come up once in a while in Klan meeting.
Taking back to the civil rights movement, and for you, what was your activity involved with it, and what do you remember? Take us back to Dr. King and what you thought of him.
Well, he gave my graduation speech at Morehouse, and I knew his brother from high school. I knew a few of the people that he knew. So naturally, I was impressed with what he was doing. It was a kind of a time, I suppose, that instituted a great deal of change, maybe more understanding later, more appreciation for the impact of segregation on people.
No justice! No peace! No justice! No peace!
When you see the marches that take place now in response to George Floyd's death or other incidents that have happened across the country, how do you compare what's going on now versus what happened back then?
Well, back then, my focus was primarily on what was going on at the University of Florida and what was going on at other schools in the South. Although people can't blame themselves for what happened 400 years ago, there's still a legacy, and much of those problems still need attention.
You went to Morehouse, you went to the Air Force, you went to the University of Florida Law, you worked on Wall Street. You had some huge key roles in a time where our country was, you know, one of the most divided it's ever been. Was it easy for you?
Well, I wouldn't say that it was easy by any means, because finding the quality of employment that I was looking for was, in fact, difficult. Took a lot of time to get on the right track. When I was growing up, you know, there were limits on where you could go, what you could do. Today, they're more subtle.
As for the advice he wants to give to younger generations?
Do the best that you're capable of doing and come out and be involved in the community, work for causes that you identify with. Accomplish as much as you can, learn as much as you can, and keep learning new things all your life.
Now, it might be hard to imagine students yelling racial slurs at their teacher, but that was the reality for 84-year-old Pearlie Harris. She was a school teacher in Greenville, South Carolina, during and after segregation. She made such a difference that she was honored as a centerpiece on a massive mural celebrating diversity and unity. Harris shared her message with Destiny Chance.
You always start out the way you want to end up.
So Miss Pearlie Harris grew up in Saluda, North Carolina, moved to Hendersonville, and ended up in Greenville.
Ended up coming back here because my husband loved this place. And he said Greenville was a small, nice small town to raise children. But when I came to Greenville, I was afraid. I mean, I was really afraid. And I had to get on the city bus. I didn't see any more black people other than me, and it was really frightful.
For 30 years, she taught between 25 and 30 schools in Greenville County.
Greenville was highly segregated back in the day, too.
How was that for you as an educator?
Almost nerve-taking to some extent, because I was among the teachers that were selected to go in all-white schools in Greenville. And the superintendent approached me and said, "We're going to send you to a new school next year, and it's going to be all white." And he says, "How do you think you'll do?" I said, "I'll be fine. Children are children." And it wasn't that hard, and it wasn't that easy, because the children literally called me. And the parents did too. Big PTA meeting. And some of the parents were really upset, because they said, "We never wanted to teach our children, because they don't know what the white teachers know, and they don't have the education." My husband was overseas in Vietnam, and I decided this will be the best year these children will ever have in school the rest of their lives. And I was determined that I was going to be that best teacher in that school because I was black.
What was your best memory during that time?
Having a parent call me and apologize for calling me the N-word. That was one of my best memories. And that literally brought me to tears. And I told her, I said, "You know, this is exceptional. Because who calls and apologizes to someone for something they said 20 years ago that literally hurt your feelings? And you now are conscious of the fact that you did this." And she said, "Because I've decided I want to be a teacher in my late years, and I want to be the person that you were."
The Unity mural on the old BB&T building on College Street, when you saw that presented to you, can you talk to me about just the significance for you when you saw it in the word unity?
Diversity, unity, love, compassion, heart, a heart. And you have to have a good heart. You have to have a love for children and people to be a teacher. And then stretch yourself out in the community. I'm amazed at the things that had happened to me in my life, because none of this I expected. I never dreamed of even sitting here with you today. But I'm proud of the fact that it is me, and I hope that it can be a part of what Greenville can say she made us proud.
Now to a pioneer in the civil rights movement and journalism. Joyce Jackson was the first black woman to be a television reporter in Oklahoma. She was also a part of the first sit-in during the civil rights movement. Jason Hackett met with Jackson for a conversation about her past and hope for the future.
They brought me down to the studio, put me in front of the cameras, and as much as I run my mouth, I couldn't talk. They kept asking me questions, and then the tears start rolling.
You cried?
Yes, I cried because I was just afraid, you know. I'm afraid of the unknown.
How was it being a black voice in a sea of white voices at that time? Did you feel the weight of those expectations?
Yes.
Them people because, looking up to you?
Yes, absolutely. But of course, I had a lot of detractors. We had a lot of calls to get that person off of the air. Why do you have that person on the air? But the community was very supportive. I think there should be a better effort to reach the community. and to make sure that the community is being being included in the story of what's going on in the nation, because right now there's a lot going on. And of course, when I was growing up, there was a lot going on.
And there's a bit of a parallel, because you were involved in the sit-ins.
Yes.
With Clara Luper, everything that went on here in Oklahoma, and now we're seeing a bit of a civil rights movement once again.
Right.
As people march in the streets and they fight for justice and they fight for inclusion.
August the 19th, 1958, is when they started the march downtown Oklahoma City to do a sit-in. And it was always nonviolent, and Ms. Luper had us trained to deal with whatever would come at us. I never would imagine that in this day and time we would still be dealing with our civil rights.
Still fighting.
Yes. But all the things that Ms. Luper told us about the color of your skin, that you are equal and you are as, I don't want to, sometimes it makes me sad and it makes me cry sometimes that here we are still trying to get justice and trying to be treated equally, and it's all because of the color of our skins.
Everybody's partisan, everybody's kind of torn apart. People are still out there marching and fighting for justice. What does the future hold for us here in America?
I think we need to go back to the things that we're taught as little kids, to be kind to each other, to respect each other, to care about each other. And Dr. Martin Luther King always said, love triumphs all. And that's what we need to do.
Still ahead on Project Community, history and hope. His picture, part of history. Meet the man who simply went to work and ended up in the middle of a movement, plus 87 years old and still fighting.
What was the Breonna Taylor investigation and more like for you?
It was the same old soup warmed over. We got satisfied with some crumbs.
They're well past retirement and should be relaxing in their golden years.
But some seniors told us until there is true equality, they'll never stop fighting. 87-year-old Maddie Jones has been on the front lines since the 1950s, and she is still winning awards for her activism. Marvis Herring caught up with Miss Maddie in Louisville, where she is still organizing protests.
I tell everybody, racism is not born in a person. Racism is taught.
Miss Maddie Jones told me she learned that lesson years after moving from Memphis, Tennessee to Louisville, Kentucky. She was in second grade.
Believe it or not, I'd walk past maybe two, three white schools, all white schools. Never thought nothing about that. I was joyous, overjoyed to get to Madison Junior High and Central High. Those were our schools, our friends was there.
She graduated as Louisville Municipal College closed and integration took effect.
That was the only college that African Americans could go to here at home.
She chose Indiana University, about 100 miles north. While there, she says penmanship, it almost landed her an on-campus job. Then the employer saw her in person.
I didn't think anything about him looking strange, but I knew he got quite uneasy. And then when he was able to, through his choked up voice, to say this to me, that's when it really hit me. That's when it created not love, not being upset, but it changed me into really being mad.
Jones joined the Black Workers Coalition. Over the years, she's planned boycotts and rallied for human rights all across the country and here at home. What was the Breonna Taylor investigation and more like for you?
It was the same old soup warmed over. When I heard of the Breonna case, my mind said to me that we have not been on the job. We haven't did what we supposed to have done. because we're in the 60s and we came through the human rights movement, we got satisfied with some crumbs. And we could move out into the suburbs. And we forgot from whence we came. And this little creature began to creep back in a more dignified, sophisticated way.
Maddie Jones turned 87 in 2020, 15 days after Louisville Metro Police killed Breonna Taylor in a controversial midnight raid. Jones attended some of those local protests, witnessing a modern-day movement layered with hope and some confusion.
We didn't have leadership. You see, during the 60s, we were trained. Before we got into the streets or anywhere, we went to a place in Newmarket, Tennessee, and Dr. Martin Luther King's aides and men that worked, and some women, they trained us how to be resistance to violence. And they explained to us and taught us what was going to happen. We didn't go out there blindsided, thinking everything was going to be all right. See, none of this happened during this last protest that we had. But I applaud those young folk for having the goodwill and the mind and the heart to step up and said, enough is enough.
Staying in Louisville, where an outspoken and energetic man has been fighting since the 1950s, Carrie Grace introduces us to Reverend Charles Elliott.
This can't lay it on the ground. And you're talking about violence. The world went crazy. They started burning up every city it was in the United States almost. We're going to overcome. We'll make it. Every time I look at that, I can't handle that, y'all.
Reverend Charles Elliott clearly remembers the day Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. was assassinated. At 86 years old, Reverend Elliott has made it his life's work to fight for justice and equality.
Well, King was telling us what hate do. He said, hate hurts the hater. It don't hurt the one you hate.
While Elliott has been a figure in Louisville for many decades, he was born and raised in the small town of Wheeler, Alabama.
Wheeler, Alabama was a very, very racist, infected business. As I tell people all the time who that interviewed me, I told him, I said, it won't nothing for me to go down in the woods because we didn't have no electrolytes, no running water. We had to go cut wood in the woods. Won't nothing to go down and find a black man hanging in a tree. Just like you hang a rabbit.
The Reverend's childhood was marked by racism. He talks about moving off the sidewalk to let white people pass and having to get in the back of a line just because of the color of his skin. That treatment played a major part in why he got involved in civil rights work.
At the time, I didn't understand. I was just tired. I was tired of having to go to the back. I was just tired.
What do we want? Justice!
The death of Breonna Taylor was among those that sparked a national outcry for justice. And the city of Louisville was put on display as protesters spent months calling for the officers who killed Taylor to be arrested.
The other thing that I never would have seen is number of white young men marching with us, talking about freedom now and justice now. No justice, no peace. All over the United States, they were marching for blacks.
For Elliott, the progress of the black community is undeniable.
God let me live to see this man here, a black man with a white mama, becoming the president of the United States. I never thought that would happen.
Talk to me about what you've seen in your life as far as from when you were a child to now. What's the most progress and what's the least progress?
That was a time we did not have the support of the law, of the politicians. None of the political people was with black. None of them. They was the one that was fighting us.
A man of great faith, Reverend Charles Elliott says in the face of adversity, he has and will always rely on one thing, and that is prayer.
When we turn this thing over to God and stop trying to do it in our own way and start to follow in His way, then we'll have a plenty.
Ahead on Project Community, History and Hope. Stepping away to make a phone call saved her life. The civil rights movement mission she knew could have been a death sentence. Plus,
I want you to remember, anything you have today is a privilege to have it.
She lived through it all. Now at 110 years old, she's sharing some memorable words of wisdom.
Some called her a portrait of courage.
Others refer to her as a living legacy of dignity. Miss Hulda Senshaus is 110 years old. The former jazz dancer was born in West Virginia, but now lives in the Boston area. She sat down for a conversation with Renelda Richardson and Richardson's 17-year-old daughter.
I'm Hulda Senshaus, and I'm 110 this month, and I want you to remember, anything you have today, it's a privilege to have it.
While civil rights leaders marched in the 60s for equality, activism showed up in Senshaus through her jazz dance shows. She founded what was Boston's Click Club to help educate black students. She shocheted me and my daughter back through 60 years of photos.
Oh, here they are. These are the two girls that taught us.
Before her joyous jazz days, some blues. Both her parents died by the time she was six. Half of her nine siblings were dead by then, too.
We didn't have any adults to raise us, so we had to raise ourselves.
Being born February 28th, 1911, you've been through a lot. Riley, you're good at history. What are some of the things she's had to go through?
We got to go through the Great Depression and World War I and World War II.
We weren't able to get butter, flour, sugar.
At 16, she moved to Woburn, Massachusetts, to an aunt's house and graduated Woburn High School, the class of 1931.
There's only two blacks.
Married at age 25, she and her husband, William, worked as domestics, her fallback plan.
I was interested in health, and I couldn't become a nurse.
Legalized racial segregation, the Jim Crow laws, threatened to rock her world, but grounded in family, the couple bonded with their white employers. It empowered them.
My husband was a chauffeur, so the lady he was working for, she would sit in the front seat with him, and the cop would say to her, you have to get in the back. And she said, this is my car. I'm sitting where I want to sit.
From your experiences, did you think it was harder being black or a woman?
It was a double whammy. It was. In those days, it was hard for a black woman.
So help me God.
I never thought I'd see a black woman vice president, which is amazing, and I'm so happy.
You weren't an activist, but you were very much an advocate of what you would stand for.
You young people, get up and get to that voting place as soon as you can get there. How about that one?
Vice President Kamala Harris always said, her mother said, that you may be the first, but make sure you're not the last. Right. Is there anything that kind of sticks out in your mind?
I just want her to appreciate what you have and use your vote.
Is there anything you can think of that your parents have kind of always said to you?
My parents have always said that to whom much is given, much is expected.
That's me.
That's you?
That's me.
She survived the Spanish flu pandemic, and she's holding her own through this one, too. Still giddy like a schoolgirl.
You should have seen me trying to get my hair together for this picture.
You remember that?
Yes, I do. I had to put my hair on the ironing board.
You put your hair on the ironing board?
Mm-hmm.
Hulda Senshaus is Black History and Hope. Still ahead on Project Community, History and Hope. Just 13 years old and put on death row. How that led to one man's lifetime of activism. But first,
I knew if they found me, it would have been another lynching that night. I mean, if you were black, you just didn't stand a chance.
You may not know her name, but she's living history.
Betty Daniels Rosemond dedicated her life to the fight for racial equality and nearly lost it. That brush with death happened 60 years ago when she was a freedom rider. The now 81-year-old lives in Cincinnati and told Ashley Kirkland she'll never forget the horrors of the past.
We knew every time we took a ride that if we died, we died.
Was there fear among you and your friends when you went out, or a fear that maybe you weren't doing the right things or going to the right places, that you would be stopped by police or harassed?
Oh, you would be stopped, but you had to, if they tell you to move, for instance, if you got on a metro bus and a white person wanted your seat, they could insist that you move and go to the back of the bus because that part was for black people. And if you didn't do what they said, you would be arrested. So that was always, you had to do it or you pay consequences.
At 21, Betty Daniels Rosemond, then Betty Daniels, decided to leave school at LSU to join the Freedom Riders.
I went through some of the training. One of the girls slapped me and almost knocked me down, but that was part of your training to see if you would retaliate, and you couldn't retaliate.
Betty and four others went on a freedom ride from New Orleans to Mobile, Alabama, just days after another group's bus was bombed.
On the way back, when we got to a little town in Mississippi, now freedom riders were testers. Their job was to test the facilities to see if they were now following the law. My job was to make a phone call. When I got off and went over to the phone booth, a truck of men, a pickup truck, white men, pull up at the little bus station. They literally dragged Frank and the three girls out, put them in the back of the truck, and drove off. Now, I knew if they found me, it would have been another lynching that night.
All of this because you were black?
Of course. Everything was because of that. I mean, if you were black, you just didn't stand a chance.
And here we sit today in 2021. We've had our first black president.
No.
We have had our first female and black and South Asian vice president. How do you feel about where we are today?
Oh, I feel good. I really do. Good to know that people were still willing to try to see that change will come. Mm-hmm. And there are still people who risk their life to see that this happens.
And do you feel that we have achieved or are close to the dream that Dr. King spoke of?
You know, we have work to do. It ain't over till God says mm-hmm. it's over. The Bible tells us this. We must love each other, love our neighbor as ourselves. We are compelled to love one another, and that's what's missing in the world today.
Oh, when Charles Best clocked in for work on February 1st, 1960, he had no idea he'd been part of history. That's him behind the counter in this famous photo from the Woolworth sit-in in Greensboro, North Carolina. Best recently returned to the store, which is now a museum. He shared his memories with Brianna Connor.
I was the busboy, and I was camera busboy. I was walking through the canal just like this right here.
At 83 years old.
I believe that's why Miss Hope kept me on here, because I can move fast.
Charles Best still hasn't slowed down.
I was saying, hot stuff, and people would get out of the way.
But he stood still for at least a moment behind the Woolworths counter in 1960.
That's me.
What do you see when you see that young man?
I'm proud of myself. I'm just proud to be a part of Woolworth.
For put me in that moment where these four young men came in, sat down at this very counter, and then refused to get up.
Every time when a waitress would tell them, we don't serve colored folks here, they would ignore that. and kept on sitting and asking for coffee. I never did hear them ask for nothing else but coffee. Everyone was looking at each other, wondering what was happening. I was standing close by, and I wondered what was going on.
Were you ever scared?
Scared?
Yeah.
No, I wasn't. I wasn't scared at all, because the reason I wasn't scared because I was glad to see it happen.
There's a new generation coming forward to do those same courageous things, to get closer to equality. And so when you look at some of the things that we experienced over the summer, even the protests that happened here in Greensboro, what did you see?
The black man has moved forward, but in some areas still haven't got there.
When you see these young people, again, it's people oftentimes who look like me out there. If you could sit down with them and talk with them, what would you say?
I would tell them that we can't accomplish nothing by being violent, but we can accomplish by praying together and just start doing what's right.
Advice for the next generation from a busboy who witnessed history, now a man determined to keep it from repeating.
I'm glad to be alive to tell the story of the sit-in movement. I'm glad. I just praise the Lord that I'm here to tell the story.
At just 13, this Mississippi man ended up on death row. Hezekiah Watkins was one of the youngest freedom riders during the Civil Rights Movement. Now, 73 years old, Watkins shares his powerful story with Cecil Hannibal.
73-year-old Hezekiah Watkins now spends his days working at the Mississippi Civil Rights Museum. Only, he's not just an employee. He's a part of history.
And so you grew up in the midst of the Civil Rights Movement. What do you remember most about that time?
Well, I remember watching the evening news. I would see dogs biting individuals. I saw individuals being spat on. I saw individuals being beaten. And I couldn't understand why. But I keep hearing these words, freedom riders.
The Freedom Riders traveled throughout the South protesting segregation and Jim Crow laws. In 1961, they came to Jackson. Watkins, just 13 at the time, disobeyed his mother by going to see the peaceful protests, only to be arrested and sent to prison.
They didn't give you any charges? They didn't give you any explanation?
Oh, nothing. When I got there, they didn't ask me nothing. They took me directly to a cell. I said, I haven't done anything. Oh yeah, you've done something. You wouldn't be here if you hadn't done anything. Did they give you a date? A date for what, sir? Did they give you a date to kill you?
At just 13 years old, Watkins was put on death row. After 5 days in prison, he says Mississippi's governor, Ross Barnett, ordered his release. From that moment on, he spent his life working as an activist, organizing boycotts and registering black voters in Mississippi. He was arrested over 100 times, often with unnecessary force.
And I'm sure you've seen the video of George Floyd. When you saw that, what came to your mind?
To see how the officer just pinned his knee on his neck and just like he forgot all about it. Treated him like he was just not human, but it made me sad. It made me want to, I don't know, do something. But then you ask yourself, what could you do?
Where are we going? Where is the country going from here after what we saw this past summer?
The way to go was to register and vote. And that's what we started on. And by registering and voting, the results is here in Mississippi. Like I said, the pudding is in the pie based on what we started years ago and based on what is happening now. And to answer your question, yes, sir, things are much better.
Still ahead on Project Community, history and hope. He found freedom with his voice overseas while dealing with segregation at home. The powerful message he's sharing today. But first, born into history.
We're watching TV and all of a sudden, boom. Christmas night, 1956, our house was bombed.
As the daughter of a civil rights leader, Ruby Shuttlesworth Bester had a front row seat to the history-making movement.
And she remembers it well. The Ku Klux Klan bombed her childhood home because of her family's fight for equal rights. But that didn't stop them from the mission. Ms. Ruby reflects on the past, present, and future with Jatara McGee at the Cincinnati church her father founded.
I want to tell the story of Birmingham.
A story that shaped Ruby Shuttlesworth Bester and the world as we know it. Her father, Reverend Fred Shuttlesworth, was molding the civil rights movement before it had a name.
Take me back to Christmas night in 1956 and tell me what you remember about when your home was bombed.
Christmas night, 1956, I was 11. My brother was 10. He had just gotten a cowboy outfit. We're watching TV and all of a sudden, boom. The bomb was between the church and the house. So the house went down on Daddy's side.
Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., her sister's godfather, had been leading the Montgomery bus boycott for a year.
We joined in that protest. And we were threatened that if we rode the buses, the house would be bombed. And it was Christmas night, 1956, our house was bombed. But on December 26, Daddy got up and rode the buses to integrate the buses. Back in the South, you had to break the law to change the law. The law was separate.
Her family moved to Cincinnati in 1961, where her father founded the Greater New Light Baptist Church in Cincinnati's Avondale neighborhood. The waves her family created in Birmingham are part of what pushed them north. In 1957, 12-year-old Ruby and her older sister were part of a small group who tried to integrate an all-white high school.
A news person was filming, and he filmed my parents driving up with us in the car to this mob crowd. As Daddy got out, he was beaten. My mother got out to help him. And as she got out, she was stabbed in her hip. My sister, in fact, won't talk about it.
The brutal beating was followed by a years-long legal fight.
Ruby Frederica Shuttlesworth versus the Birmingham Board of Education.
You didn't have it easy. What kept you going?
Well, the Lord. Then I had a daddy that didn't allow you to cry. You never let them see you be weak.
You were alive for both, for the civil rights movement and for the Black Lives Matter movement. What were the main differences?
Many, many, many more people that were not African American.
What do you want those activists and those people who were protesting to know?
I want them to know that they're doing good. First of all, they're nonviolent. And I always wanted to say, if I could talk to the leaders, because there's always somebody in the line that's going to act a fool, I just wanted to call them and say, when they start acting a fool, back up 3 steps. You're not with us. See, back in the days, we prepared for people that will come in and mess up the line.
She says their struggles made them stronger, and the history her generation holds must be taught to strengthen the next.
our history as a people has been and is hope because we've been moving forward.
Next on Project Community, History and Hope. His talent won him praise everywhere, except his own country.
So I'd sung in a lot of opera houses, like in Rome and London and Vienna, Geneva, Switzerland, Spain. They still wouldn't let me sing in some of the opera houses in this country.
How that adversity only made him stronger. Next.
His voice brought him fame across the globe.
Well, everywhere except his own home. Dr. Simon Estes is an internationally acclaimed opera singer. He launched his career during the Civil Rights Movement and has performed on every continent except Antarctica. Now, he's a professor in Des Moines. And as he reflects on his past with Kayla James, he shares a powerful message for future generations.
My name is Simon Estes. I'm an opera singer and a professor. I was born in Centerville, Iowa, back in 1938.
This is the voice of the internationally acclaimed bass baritone opera singer, Dr. Simon Estes, a University of Iowa and Juilliard School of Music graduate, an opera singer who performed in front of global leaders, taught as a professor at universities across the world, but for years found it hard to perform in the U.S. due to the color of his skin.
In the mid-70s, I'd sung in a lot of opera houses, like in Rome and London and Vienna, Geneva, Switzerland, Spain. They still wouldn't let me sing in some of the opera houses in this country. And I remember I called my mother, because I was living in New York then, and I called my mother, she was out here, and I was, you know, mother, and I will admit tears, I was crying, I said, they won't let me sing at the Met, and they won't let me sing in a lot of the opera houses, and I've sung all these houses. And my mother said, well, son, now you just get down on your knees and you pray.
You spent a while in Europe.
Well, I've lived in Europe more than I have in the United States because I started singing in 65.
Was there a notable difference in how you were treated as a black singer from Europe to America?
Yes. That's what made me very sad. I'm not saying there was no discrimination in Europe. There was. But the people there judged me, like Martin Luther King said, on my character and on my talent and not my skin color. We were singing out in San Francisco, but they were probably being paid $15,000, maybe $20,000 a performance for singing the lead roles as tenors. They paid me $257 a performance.
The Civil Rights Movement.
Right.
Did that have any impact on your career?
I remember when Martin Luther King gave his great speech, I heard him speak. Actually, I heard him speak in person when I was a student at the University of Iowa. And Martin was somebody who really inspired me and to treat hatred with love.
You were a young adult during the Civil Rights Movement.
Mm-hmm.
And now, a little more than five decades later, we're seeing a movement that occurred last year after the killing of George Floyd.
And to see all what has happened this year, last year, the year 2020, was a tough year. I just said to my wife, I said, I'm tired. I'm just tired. And they say, oh, we don't have any discrimination in America. It does still exist.
What has to change?
The only way I think that we're going to reduce discrimination in the United States is parents need to start teaching their children at a very young age.
A lot of people have called what occurred after the killing of George Floyd the young people's movement, or this generation's movement. For the young people who are out there leading, what do you want them to know?
You can only drive out hate with love. So my suggestion is, let's give love a chance.
We've heard stories of strength, heartbreak, and inspiration. The common theme, we've come a long way, but there's still work to be done.
For Project Community, History, and Hope, we spoke to more than two dozen seniors. We are so thankful for their time and their willingness to be so open and share some difficult memories from the past.
But it's their message of hope that we still should all hang on to and use as a guiding force to make life better for everyone. To watch the rest of their stories, head over to our website, WAPT.com. We end with a preview of that powerful content. Thank you so much for joining us.
I guess the question is today, how far have we come? Not far, not far enough.
Don't be afraid to speak out. Don't be afraid to stand for what you believe.
We must love and support one another.
Be proud of who you are.
Get involved in your communities.
If you give up, that's when you lose the fight. You cannot wait for someone else to come in and do it. You must finish the work.
To remind America of the fierce urgency of now.
I am here as a voice for the voiceless.
Whatever you believe in, and if it's right, don't get away from it. Don't let nobody take that from you. Stand your ground, stand up, and do it intelligently. And do it, and then do it peacefully.
Across this world, it wasn't just in the United States. Blacks, whites, Latinos, Asians, marching together, saying this is wrong. We need to do something about it. Enough is enough.
I hope for more equality, and the main thing, I hope for more truthfulness and peace.